Hey, what's going on, guys? Welcome back to another episode of One of Each. I'm your host for this evening, John Shin, and of course, from wherever you guys are tuning in from across the world, I hope you guys are doing well. I'm going to borrow a phrase here from the UK's very own Margs and Loons of the No Behavior podcast. Margs likes to call Loons in his introduction. He says, the coldest co-host in co-host history. The guest that we have for today's episode is actually quite the opposite of being the coldest co-host in co-host history. But Jimmy Kim is nonetheless the co-host for my show, Benchwarmers, here on my channel. And he, as annoying as he can be at times and as trolly as he can be at times, deep inside, he's a very warm, kind-hearted fellow who cares a lot about his people. And I thought just one day, why not take this opportunity to also allow the Thick Luck Fam community to get to know Jimmy a little bit better. So what I decided to do was take Jimmy back to his roots as kind of like a part one series of Jimmy Kim, the man. And we took him back to his hometown in somewhere in the outskirts of Philadelphia. And we took a drive out there. It was an absolutely ridiculous drive. It's normally about an hour and a half, maybe 2 hours. The traffic made it exponentially worse, but it was a good time because we got to go out there and we also got to link up with some friends in PA, and it was a good time nonetheless. This episode, we had a good time filming, and I kind of got to learn a little bit more about Jimmy Kim myself. You know, I've known him for a very long time now. There's always things that you get to learn from each other, and there's always things that you learn about each other, and I guess that's the mission of One of Each. And funnily enough, there's somebody that I thought I knew very well, I got to learn more about him when we went down there. So hopefully you guys enjoy this one. If you guys do enjoy this one, let me know in the comment section below. And hopefully if we do get a good reaction, we can maybe do more episodes of Jimmy Kim, because I know some people love Jimmy Kim, but some people also despise him. And I wanted to take this opportunity to kind of let you guys know that as much as he is the wild co-host, he is a good fella at the end of the day. So hopefully you guys enjoy this episode. And make sure you guys let me know in the comment section below if you want more Jimmy Kim content. We're going to get straight into it. As always, guys, we're trying to hit 10K subs by the end of the summer transfer window. So please hit that subscribe button. If you guys have not yet done so, hit that notification bell as well, so you guys are always up to date on whenever we're dropping new video. And yeah, enjoy the episode.
I won something from the crane behind me.
Yeah. Can I ask you how old you are?
I'm 27 years old.
How old are you?
I'm 27 years old.
Wow, and you just played this?
Yeah. I won something.
He's playing again. Oh. This is how to get you.
I lost. Oh, I got another chance.
Jimmy, can you talk to us a little bit about where we are right now?
We're in New Jersey.
Uh-huh.
This is the Thomas Edison, what is it called? Service station. I used to come here a lot when I used to drive up to New York every week.
Uh-huh.
My family would stop here all the time.
So,
it used to just be called the Edison stop, but I think they changed it to Thomas Edison a few years ago.
Nice. What's on the agenda today? What are we doing?
So John and I are going to be going down to this small town called Pottstown in Pennsylvania. That's where I lived from 4 years old to 16 years old. 12 years of my life was spent there. I think we're just gonna go there and see my old place that I used to live in.
Are you excited?
No, not really. That place was boring. There was not much going on there. And I'm pretty sure everything changed. So I don't really know what's gonna happen, but we'll see what's going on there. Ah, I'm glad. There's something, some things never change. There always used to be a random basketball court that no one owned, but there'd always be a basketball here. And I see one right there. You see how rickety these?
It's not even up.
It feels weird. It actually changed a lot. Like, I wouldn't have expected the two big trees here to be gone, because they were like staples of this place. but I don't know who lives here anymore, but you see this building? So there's 6 units in on every floor, and there's 3 floors. Mm-hmm. Those two on the right, on the bottom, and the two in the middle, that's where I used to live. Kind of looks smaller to what I remember, to be honest. I thought it would be huge. That's what it was like when I was a kid. But if you see all the way out there, like where the grass is out there, that's where the cows used to be. And me and my friends at night during the summers would always go there and touch the cows and stuff.
Touch
the cows.
Can you specify what you mean?
Like we go up to cows and be like, yo, what's good?
You would pet them?
Yes.
Okay.
But I actually have legacy here. Come over here. Also, there used to be, what is that thing called? The horseshoe thing? Is it called horseshoe? There used to be 2 plots, like squares of sand and 1 metal rod. And then you would throw horseshoes at them. I think it's called horseshoe. But yeah, in the summer as a kid, my friends and I would play that too. What kind of tree is that? It's a pine tree. But in Pennsylvania, we always celebrated Earth Day. And one year when I think it was 2nd or 3rd grade for Earth Day, our elementary school gave us little saplings of pine tree. And so my grandma planted them, and I'm pretty sure these are those 2 pine trees me and my sister got. So I'm glad that they're still here. And I know it's them because we planted them next to this big tree right here, which wasn't a pine tree. By the time we left, I think it was actually only half this height, so I'm surprised it grew this much. I used to live in Philly before I moved here. I used to live in a place called Norristown, and that was not a nice neighborhood. And when I was a kid, my family used to live in like a studio with like 6 people. So it was not a good situation. But when we moved here, as I mentioned before, we had 2 apartments and each one had 2 rooms. So it was basically 4 bedrooms. And so it was really nice. I never got to live in my own room until I moved to New York, because when I lived here, I just lived in the living room. Like I would pull out my bed, put it on the ground, and then just sleep there every night. So like no actual room. It was a really nice area. The people here are really nice and pretty decent area to be living in. Yeah, of course. Like I said, when I was a kid, my summers were just filled with playing at this basketball court behind us. The swimming pool that used to be here, and like I mentioned, golf balls used to always be hit into that cornfield in the summer. And so my friends and I would just collect golf balls. And then at the end of the day, we would just hit all of them back into the cornfield with like golf clubs or a baseball bat. Yeah, I'm sure, you know, a lot of people that have lived in this kind of area that, you know, aren't Caucasian will tell you the same thing where, you know, in elementary school, you know, kids are kids. They don't really know what differences are. You get along with everyone, you play with other people, you get the weird, you know, as a kid you get the weird situation here and there where, like, you know, on your birthday at my elementary school, your family would like send cupcakes or a cake for your classroom. And you know, being Asian and Korean, you know, my family would bring like Korean pies almost. And I remember when I was in first grade and I first brought them, everyone was just so like confused as to what it was. They loved it because it was basically just a chocolate. It's called choco pie, which is a chocolate cake with marshmallow filling. And so when they looked at it, they're like, I have no idea what it is. And they're very hesitant. But once they ate it, they were like, oh, this is great. But then it's middle school, really, where, you know, I have an older sister and her and I both did go through some sort of, you know, there were like not fights, but arguments with other kids asking like, oh, you know, that's when like you really start to hear the stereotypes of like, why aren't you good at math, or you know, any other, you know, educational stereotypes there are for Asians. But for me, I didn't really go through that because I tried my best to fit in, which was basically do everything the school offered, which was sports, music, clubs, anything. I joined everything so I could be friends with everyone. So like I was friends with the music kids, I was friends with the, you know, the smart kids, I was friends with the athletes. It was because I didn't want anyone to think I was any different from them. So, you know, I would be friends with the athletes. You know, I would play sports with them. I was on the teams with them. And they know me, so they wouldn't really say anything. But, you know, for my sister, it was harder because she wasn't as outgoing, I'd say, as me. And she would only focus on her studies. So for her, it was really rough. But for me, it actually wasn't that bad. I just remember the biggest fight I ever had with a classmate per se was in the sixth grade when this, I remember his name, I won't say him, but I'll call him Frank. But Frank would always harass me about not being good at math. Like, he was in the highest math class and I was in like the middle math class, and he would always harass me during homeroom asking why I wasn't good at math. And I remember I blew up on him one day and I was like, it's really mean, but he was like a really rude kid. So I used to always tell him like, you know, stop it. But that one day I blew up. I was like, this is why you have no friends. And I got sent to the principal's office. But it's those things where it's like, you know, he says that every day and nothing happens, but I say one thing to him and I get reported. But it's...
Did you feel upset?
No, I loved it. I freaking... he didn't really say anything to me after that. And we became friends in high school. And that's usually like the way it happens. Like, you know, you fight with these kids in middle school because of the differences, and then, you know, you realize you're stupid in high school and then you become friends with them. But I mean, that's really my experiences here, is I just tried to do everything and try to fit in with everyone, which, you know, looking back at it now, it sort of is the way I am now, because I try to be nice to everyone and I try to be friends with everyone, and it's in my personality to not want people to dislike me.
Right.
It's not bad, but it's both harmful in a way and also good in a way.
Sure.
Because that makes people like me as well.
Sure.
But also it's like, it sets me up to be this person that I don't really want to be.
Pots Town, baby!
Yeah, so for context's sake, I lived with my mom since I was 1 year old. And just my mom and my sister and, you know, our immediate family on my mom's side. But my mom worked at a dry cleaner's her whole life. Recently, during the pandemic, the dry cleaner she was working at had to close due to, you know, the financial struggles during during COVID. But she's working somewhere else now. But for me, I never really thought about any differently than, you know, my friends who had parents that were nuclear engineers, like doctors, the lawyers and stuff. But for me, it was just hard because they would have, like, you know, 9-to-5 jobs, you can take off, take breaks. But, you know, being an Asian American and your parents being from Korea, you know, they really took that leap to come to a new country. And they, you know, I'm sure John can relate to this as well, but they don't really take days off. And for me, the most difficult part wasn't understanding the job she did. It was more not being able to understand, you know, when you go on field trips, you know, you need chaperones. Not once did, was my chaperone ever someone from my family. I always had to be chaperoned with a friend, or, you know, not someone that I didn't even know in my classroom. And it was always weird, especially in elementary school and middle school, where, you know, you get to see your friends go on field trips with their parents and, you know, they're having fun, and I'm just having to be by myself with my, you know, my friends' parents as well. I think that was the hardest part about this area. I think, you know, I'm just really thankful that my mom was able to support both of me and my sister here. Of course, it's really hard. She worked like 12, 13, 14 hour days every day, 6 days a week. And, you know, that's hard on anyone. I think she raised us really well, because both my sister and I didn't really, you know, argue that much with her about it. Like, she was very good at parenting. My mom actually, this is a side note, tangent, but my mom actually graduated college with a bachelor's in family psychology, I think. Or like something with like family and how to raise kids. So I think that goes in. Me and my sister always talk about that with my mom, is if she didn't get that degree, me and my sister wouldn't have turned out to be, you know, good people. And, you know, as a kid, you want your parents to be around, and not having one parent already and having your other parent always be out, you know, 12 hours a day. It was rough as a kid, but, you know, I got used to it. And my personality, I'm sure John can attest, is I'm not that fussed about a lot of things. I think that's where it comes from, is as a kid, you know, I had to grow up knowing that, like, there were things out of my control. There were things that I couldn't say because that's what the situation was. And that's why, you know, now I'm not really fussed about much. You know, if we go eat, I'm usually never the person to be like, sucks. You know, this food sucks. I'm usually always, it's okay. I'll eat it again. Maybe not pay my own money. If someone buys it for me, I'll eat it again. But, you know, I'm never too fussed. And I think that's where that comes from, is, you know, not being able to do a lot of things that I wanted to do as a kid. But I'm still thankful because my mom was able, as I got older, my mom was able to provide more out of the little money that she was making already for what me and my sister wanted to do. So that was good. I'm not gonna lie, one of the first things that I thought of when John asked me to come down here and do this was, I really did wonder if the trees that my grandma planted when I was like 7 years old was still here. And it is, it's right there. It's really interesting because my grandma used to have like a plot of, like, she used to garden here. So she used to grow like tomatoes and, like, you know, in Korean it's called perilla leaf or gennip. And she used to grow those too, right next to this tree. And my first thought was, I wondered how big that tree got, because by the time I left it was like maybe half the size, maybe 3/4 the size of it is right now. So it's crazy, but I really just honestly wanted to know how much it changed. And to be honest, the vibe hasn't changed. A lot of things, you know, maybe, you know, have gone away, like the volleyball net, the huge trees that used to be here, but the buildings look the same, the vibe is the same. It's just really quaint, really quiet. And that's like what I remember from this place, was how quiet it was. I was wondering how much I would still be into this area. Because when I was when we moved up to New York, I was like, I want to move back here because I hate New York. You know, it's a city. It's too loud for me. And I'm back here, and I'm sure you can hear in the background, there's like a bell noise that used to always be there too. And it just reminds me that the reason why I'm not a big cities person is because I lived here for so long. And this is like sort of the vibe I like.
This is who you are.
This is who I am, just quiet.
So are you suggesting that at one point in your life you would like to return to the
main? Not, okay, let me get this straight. This vibe is what I like, which means where I live now is actually very similar in the sense that it's also very quiet where I live. It's very, it's not quaint. There's not a lot of like trees and a lot of nature, but it just reassures to me that I like quieter areas more than I do like the hustle and bustle of Manhattan, almost.
Do you miss, now that we're ready to go back, do you miss New York?
No.
So you want me to leave you here?
No. Take me with you, just let's not go to Manhattan.
Okay, cut. So I want to take a couple pictures of you.
Okay.